The Mesa City Council Study Session. The first item on our agenda is to review the agenda for the formal council meeting upstairs, so please take a look at that document. We went over this in our previous study session, but let's see if anybody has had any questions arise since that time. The first item are various purchasing contracts, followed by a couple of resolutions. And item 5 is introduction of an ordinance. 6 is taking public comment on an ordinance. And that concludes the meeting. It's a pretty short agenda, actually. Any questions or concerns about the consent agenda? Okay, hearing none, we'll just expect that to, everything will stay on the consent agenda then. The next item on our agenda for this study session is to hear a presentation and discuss the fiscal year 2017-18 summary of the proposed budget. Candace, good to have you with us. We look forward to, you're going to be a regular part of our meetings here going forward in the next month or two.
Well, the budget will be a regular part of your meetings.
Okay.
Mayor, good evening, Mayor and Council. Today with me, I have Candace Canestraro, the Management and Budget Director. And today with me, I have Brian Ritchell, one of the Deputy Budget Directors in our office. And we are going to be talking today about the proposed budget overview for 17-18. So this is really going to kick off, like you said, a lot of the discussion revolving around the fiscal year 17-18 budget that's coming up. So we're going to start today with an overview of what is being proposed for fiscal year 17-18. All of the other meetings in April will then come back with various department presentations that'll get into more details about those particular departments and the changes we're proposing for next year. And then we'll be wrapping that up at the end with kind of a budget wrap-up of a summary of everything that was come out to you. So what you have in your packet is kind of a detailed version, and we're going to be just hitting the highlights, but there is a detailed City Council report. If you did pull it up at one point where we didn't have the bookmarks showing, it does have bookmarks, so it is a very long once, if you pull it up now, you should have bookmarks on the side if you want to go to particular sections. So we want to make sure that you understand that, don't have to scroll through all 28 pages. So as we get going, just to give an overview, excuse me. Every time we're working on the budget, one of the things that we want to focus on is the effort for the city has on creating and maintaining a great place to live, work, and play. So these are some of the things that we go through. Whenever we're looking at adjustments to the budget, whether it's increases or decreases, we always want to make sure that we're keeping these in mind. Back in February, we came and spoke to you a little bit about the financial status of the city. And at that time, we identified that there was a funding gap between the estimated annual expenses and then the forecasted available resources. This is not that graph, it's just showing you graphically what it looks like. One of the things that we talked about is that the increased pressure from the pension, the health care, and minimum wage changes have actually widened that gap. So while we were closing that gap over time and we were coming very close to having a very minimal gap between those two, unfortunately that is widening for the upcoming fiscal year, and that's what we're addressing today. Back in February, we also showed you a forecast of our general governmental fund over a multi-year period. We do want to come back and update that a little bit for you, as it has been a couple of months. So some of the things that we do update on that is the last time we came, we talked about it being a forecast, so it truly was a forecast. At this point, we have gone in and updated all of the positions in the city with the actual employees that are in those positions. And what usually happens with that is that as we have turnover during the year, the higher paid senior positions employees leave and are replaced with the lower level, entry level kind of positions, and there's some savings that occur. And so that did happen as we went in and actually updated those positions. So if we look at the overall forecast, we see it says updated forecast there. So this will look, I kind of outlined the 17-18 fiscal year, and those are the numbers that we have updated. So we've updated a little bit. So when we look at our uses, you'll see the uses, those are our expenses, are a little bit lower than we originally looked at in February because we've actually updated those with their actual positions and the employees. And so it gave us a little bit better position, slightly better, that we're forecasting now for the end of 17-18 as we look at those. This then becomes our starting point. when we're looking at all the different departments and the various expenses for next year, this is our starting point. And one of the things that we handed out to you today is that you'd have it, it's a little bit easier to look at, is kind of the beginning and the end of what the discussion we're going to have today. It's also an attachment in the packet online, so everybody does have access to that as well. But that's basically our starting point, and they're going to show you how we're going to get to our ending point for the proposed budget. One of the things that we talk about when we talk about financial sustainability is the balance of two things. It's the balance of the needs of today, along with the balance of preparing for the growth and the opportunities of tomorrow. And every time we look at the budget and we make adjustments, we want to make sure that we're dealing with both of those, both today and tomorrow, that we're not just being nearsighted, but we're looking out to where we want to grow into the future. And so for this, the focus for our 17-18 proposed budget is the maintaining of our core services that we provide here in the city, while also continuing to invest in economic development for the growth for tomorrow. One of the areas that we talked about previously is the fact that the City of Mesa is a service organization. We provide services, and for services that requires people, and that's highly skilled people, for us to provide the quality services that we try to provide. When we look at our general governmental section, these are the pie charts for this fiscal year. So 16-17, we haven't updated them for next year at this point, but it's very similar from year to year. And it's just a reminder that when we're looking at the services that are provided in our general governmental arena, we're talking about personal services. And so almost 73% of all the expenses that were budgeted for this year was related to position costs. So this would not be temporary employees, these would be actually city employees. When we also break it down just by the different areas, we need to remember that of that, public safety is just over 62% of all expenses that occur in the general governmental area. So obviously, as we're looking for adjustments to the upcoming budget, we'll be looking at personal services and looking at public safety as well. There were four different methods that we used when we approached our 17-18 fiscal year budget. And they're kind of itemized, they're listed out here, but we're going to go through each one of them and the changes that were made. Two of them do not result in impacts to our services, to our customers. The other two do have service impacts to those. The first one we want to talk about is limiting what we call step pay increases. So that's the City of Mesa terminology for step pay. And then what that is the city's compensation structure allows for employees to move through their pay range. Pay ranges are of a minimum salary and a maximum salary. And the compensation package that we have here allows for movement up toward that, through the pay range. We refer to that as step pay, as they step through the pay range. During the recession, the step pay was put on hold, so there wasn't any step pay for a number of years. The proposed budget, and it was then reinstated back in fiscal year 12-13. The proposed budget includes a 3%, up to 3% for eligible employees. This differs from the forecast and the fact that the forecast was estimating a 5% maximum for the step pay. So this allows employees to continue to progress through their pay ranges, but also allows the city to achieve ongoing savings. The savings that we've estimated for the general fund is about $2.4 million per year. That would be ongoing savings. And it's equivalent to about 23 average paid positions within the city. The second area is cost minimization. And when we look at these, we're looking at those positions that cost the most in order to provide those services. And how can we minimize those costs while still providing quality services? Because our sworn employees are the ones who are the value, the cost of those employees or those positions are going up the fastest. The departments, both the police department and the fire and medical department, both took a look at all of their sworn positions and tried to identify those positions that could possibly the duties be performed by a civilian rather than a sworn. Sometimes we refer to this as the civilianization of a position. Within those, the police department has identified 15 positions that they feel could be, the duties could be taken over by a civilian. And fire department has identified one position. This will actually, the savings on this will be the savings between the cost of those two positions. This does result in a transition period because those positions are indeed filled at this time. They're performing those duties. So what would happen is we would add the civilian positions to the city. They would be recruited and filled, and once they were filled, the sworn employees would move to another sworn position within the city. If there's not a budgeted vacant position, they would still continue in their duties, and we would apply temporary funds to the department until, just based on attrition and turnover, a budgeted vacant position would be available for them. So this does have a transition period. We're identifying about a $2 million in temporary funds that would fund these personnel until a budgeted position becomes available.
How long is the transition period to civilianize those 16 positions?
We're probably looking at about a one-year transition period, but it wouldn't be all of them for the whole year. It would be as, there's about 33 positions per year that are turned over. In the police department would be an example. So about 33 positions turn over each year. And so we already have some in the academy that are already coming in to be filled. And then we would be looking at these to fill those in. So depending on people who are in the drop program, we know when they're going to leave because they're a scheduled departure. And then we have the unscheduled departures that we can look at. So we'll be taking a look at those. That's why we estimated about $2 million. It's about $2.7 million total for these particular positions per year. But we figure over the course of the year, some of them will be able to place right away, and then some will continue during the year. Now, these employees are still here. They would actually be savings in overtime once the civilian is in place and those duties have been transferred over. Those positions, those employees are available, and so there would be a decrease in overtime because they'd be call takers. They'd be able to fill in for a sick vacation holiday, those types of things as well. So there's a balance between temporary funding, and then we'd also have a savings in the overtime of the budgeted positions.
Thank you. I think Mr. Brady.
So I was just going to say, so the earlier we can identify an individual who can backfill the administrative position, the civilian position, then it allows us to take that sworn position and put it into the field or operations. And one of the ways we can do that is because then we can, it'll help us manage our overtime a lot easier, because now we can do it with someone who's just making straight time versus overtime. And so that'll help us, give us more of a pool of sworn positions to be able to fill our needs in the field. But this will take a little, we're just saying it's going to take a little time because we're not laying off sworn positions, but it does give us a bigger pool of sworn positions once we've identified an individual for the civilianized position.
Mr. Luna.
Just real quick, so they become salaried positions, so there would be no overtime associated. Is that correct?
With the civilian positions?
Correct. Okay.
Correct.
And can you give an example of what that is? For example, currently have a sworn position in an area. Give me an example of one.
Sure. Mayor and Vice Mayor Luna, a couple of the examples would be some of the evidence officers, our range personnel. So we have sworn personnel out at the range, the gun range. Hiring detectives that we've got in place, some district coordinators. Those are some of the examples of some of the positions that have been identified by the police department. And on the fire side is the alarm room captain. So
Mayor and Council, we initiated this idea of civilianizing some position. We've been doing it for a while. I think what we're just saying is continue to pursue that even further along. We've started 4 or 5 years ago having civilians do some of the crime scene investigations and assisting with that in that area. So we see that that's a trend across the country. You're seeing more and more of the forensics and administrative responsibilities being able to be brought in on a civilian side. So we've moved a lot of we used to have a lot of sworn officers in the finance and HR, purchasing. We've begun to kind of move them and keep them back in the field, and instead having civilian individual fill those positions.
Okay. Mr. Winkle.
On March 29th, we got a message or a memo saying that Chief Dvorak is announcing 25 additional officers to be put to patrol, and then we're talking about 15 on a decrease here. What's the 10?
I think they're two different items.
Mayor and Councilmember Winkle, they're two different items. So he's talking about this is taking positions and creating civilian positions, taking the personnel and putting them into other positions that already exist somewhere else within the department. I believe what Chief Dvorak is talking about is reassignment And which on the next one we'll talk about fire doing something very similar in this as well, is reassigning the sworn position that will stay a sworn position and reassigning the duties so that they're more of a street duty rather than the duty that we're having before. So that there are two separate issues, and they will be coming back to do a presentation. We have a public safety one of the Thursdays for your meetings is public safety. We'll be doing both police department and the fire and medical department, and they can go into a little bit more details on their implementation plan.
So just so I'm clear, a year from now, we think we will have accomplished all the civilianization.
Hopefully we're civilized now.
Civilianization. A year from now, we think we can phase in those 15 police positions and one fire position will be occupied by civilians rather than sworn personnel.
That's correct. I believe that we would have them occupied by civilians much sooner than that, as fast as we can get the positions and the recruitments and the right candidates in place. Yeah. It would be the placement of the sworn personnel then into a vacant position at that point. They would still be here, and they would actually, we would consider them, there's a term that we use is called overhires. What it means is they're available. There's more people available than positions for a short time period, and so they kind of fill in instead of doing overtime. Bringing somebody in, they would actually, these people would be able to fill in at straight time.
So, Mayor and Council, so for a period of time, and even right now, we actually have more positions filled, sworn. Some of them are in FTO, but even with this program, we'll have a great larger pool of sworn officers than technically on the books positions for them to go into. Now, we're going to use them. We'll use, be able to use them to cut back on overtime. So, actually, the total amount number of sworn officers versus the positions that are in the budget will actually be higher. You know, we'll have more bodies than we actually have positions. So Candace anticipating that is providing a little additional dollars to absorb that while we make this transition. Because we're going to have sworn officers that are going to be able to move it behind a desk and put them back out in the field. We'll still use them, but it'll be a little bit more than what we currently are authorized for. We can do that temporarily, but we couldn't do it for the long term without impacting the budget significantly. So it just allows us, while we're filling a position with a civilian and placing a sworn officer back out in the streets, it just gives that period of time of making that transition so we get back to the current authorized positions. Is that right? I mean, I'm saying that, I think that makes sense.
That's correct. That, yeah. And Mayor and Council, what we do is when we're looking at, especially on the police side, because it does take a long time for the training before a recruit can go and act on their own in a shift, we do manage the personnel and the positions slightly separately. The goal is that every budgeted position has a person in it at all times when it comes to the sworn. And so sometimes what that does is it ends up with more personnel than we actually have positions, and we manage that, and usually offset with overtime, they're able to stay within their budget while they do it. The goal is to create their minimum staffing and keep it that way.
Thank you. Mr. Freeman, then Mr. Thompson.
Just listening to the presentation, I think we have to be careful on how we present things, because I know employees, especially when you say the police department, and you're moving positions around and you are guys out there and women in the field are saying, well, what positions are going to be cut, or we're not necessarily cut but reassigned in different areas. So there's a lot of chatter out there, and I appreciate your sensitivity. I think we need to be sensitive to those people out there with boots on the ground. With that, and then coming back with an actual budget presentation in the future on what positions will be reassigned and then putting the civilians in there. So I just think being conscious of what we say here extrapolates out in the field, and then we don't want the wrong information out there, that we're trying to work hard on the budgeting process and get the appropriate amount of personnel in the field that affects our community.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson.
Well stated. Is this, so the reassignment of the civilianization of these 15, is that one of the reasons we're not doing the June academy?
No, that was independently decided before we even had these recommended to us. So that's a separate issue.
So by not having the June academy, will that have a trickle-down effect over time? As you have officers that are entering drop, and then we're not making up
that? Yeah, we already know that the retirement schedule is not a mystery. It's pretty well known, and that's already built into our system of knowing how many positions we need to have in academies and how many have to be ready during a period of time to step into those positions. So we're very comfortable with that. We have 40 overhires right now?
I believe so.
40 overhires right now. So we're probably more on the higher end of available officers to absorb retirements or those who depart from the city. So we're comfortable with that. What this creates another element of, that we've identified positions, which we'll list, they're almost all administrative positions that are currently being serviced. An assignment has been made to a sworn position. We'd like to fill those positions with a civilian person, not a sworn position, when there's a significant differential in cost. As we do that, that position or that individual in the sworn position will have to have some place to go to. We're not laying off police officers. And then so for some period of time, the chiefs will have to figure out a way to assign them in the field another assignment. Now, as we know, every year there's a bidding process for shifts, but also it will give us a little bit more time, as you're suggesting also, even with retirements. And we may look at the next academy, not the June one, maybe another one. It'll help us decide on how big, how large that academy might need to be in the future. So all those things will come into play. The good news is for this city, we're gonna have a fairly large pool of sworn officers versus the number of positions that are authorized. So we'll take a little time as we transition, as we fill positions are currently filled, are being assigned to a sworn. It'll take a little bit of time just to move people around and get them in the right position. So we think that's a year. There's a lot of factors that could decide that. But I think the most important thing is we're anticipating that there are savings here, but it's all not going to happen the first year. What Candace is saying is, we need to do this now because it takes a while for all these pieces to kind of fall in place. And even though we're moving sworn out of administrative positions, we have to have a place for them to go. So for a period of time, while we may see a reduction in overtime because we have a larger pool of sworn officers that can be assigned to pick up on sick leaves and vacation leaves and things like that, we're still gonna be paying more than what we have budgeted for those positions for a period of time. Then over time, you can see, imagine how the attrition takes, of those positions, not attrition, but as people retire, then those positions become available. We're not paying for an extra position anymore. They'll fall in line with the current authorized positions.
Okay, and then to Councilmember Freeman's, what he said a while ago is, you know, the messaging, I think we should be cognizant of that, especially since we just went out with question one, talking about how much we needed officers and firefighters to come back now saying we're gonna start reassigning some here and there and so
yeah,
forth.
Yeah, and remember,
so
the positions that are being civilianized, we've been doing this for some time. This is not new, and these are positions that are not in the field providing direct services. Mm-hmm. We've tried to deal with those that are more in the administrative, and we will have, you'll see that list that'll may be available. So it really shouldn't, it's not gonna affect the delivery of services. We are trying to be creative and following up on programs we've already started where we have civilians doing some of the work on the investigative and evidence collection. So we're just expanding those programs.
Yes, Mr. Whitaker.
I have a question. What dictates whether you need a sworn personnel or just a non-sworn? Like, is that a legal definition that you have to fill certain positions with, or how do you determine that?
Mayor and Councilmember Whitaker, that would be a great question for the police department and the fire medical department.
Yeah, but a sworn officer has to meet certain standards required by the state and go through a specific training. You know, there's just the one of the things we asked each of the chiefs is, look, there are, by state law, there are certain actions, responsibilities that only an individual who has a sworn officer, who has been designated that through specific curriculum and training, can perform. And whether enforcing the laws or providing types or specific high-skilled responsibilities. They have to be a sworn position. So we've identified what are those core competencies that only they can do being designated that as they go through specific training, the academies, and the oath that they take. So that we're looking at those jobs and focusing their work on that. There's many positions, though, that are sworn, but they're also functioning in HR, procurement, a variety of administrative that are not, that, or even investigative and evidence collecting that could be done and are being done by those who have not gone through the specific academy, but they have in their educational background and specific training are competent to fulfill those responsibilities. Does that help? And we'll give examples of that when they come.
Yeah, that helps. So just to clarify what you said earlier, police was able to identify 15 positions that could be converted from sworn to non-sworn. Fire could only find one position that could be converted from sworn to non-sworn.
Well, Mayor and Councilmember Whitaker, they actually identified additional administrative positions, and they're on the next slide. We're just doing something a little different
they
with
just
them.
Call, we call it something
so,
different.
So, right, side. No, it looks a little weird that they only could identify one, but they actually identified a total of six. Really seven, one to that would move to a civilian position, and then the other five that they were actually going to be moving out of the administrative positions, those duties would be either reduced, like their training. They have a training captain. That training captain would only come in and do training at particular times versus being a full-time. And then other duties that would be reassigned where they took two captains and put the duties of both under one and took the one captain and moved him back out into the field. So they did identify additional positions that just the direction and action we're taking with those is slightly different than just the true civilianization.
Okay. Was there estimated cost savings that you had put together for moving this around, or is that on
we'll
another slide?
Yeah, we'll cover that. We'll bring that, all that together on the when we bring the departments
okay.
in.
Okay.
Just for messaging purposes, to address the question Mr. Thompson raised earlier, we're not laying off police officers. We're not saying that we have a less of a need for public safety personnel than we anticipated and we're overhired. What we're saying is we're saving money by doing some civilianization of some of those positions, but we still have a need for additional public safety personnel. For example, right. we don't have a fire station in District 6 because we don't have the firefighters for it.
And I'll be clear, that's why clear, we will have for a short period of time more bodies than we have positions. The real need for the city is to increase the number of positions for right. certain officers to serve throughout the city. It's just that while we're trying to be very efficient and effective with the competencies and trying to say, here's a position, maybe it's better that the sworn position is out in the field than sitting behind a desk. So I think hopefully it sends a message too that we're trying to be very wise with the dollars we have. And it's not that a sworn officer can't do very well behind a desk, but the cost of that officer now has become such that it's very difficult economically to justify having them do that work, which in many cases they do a great job, and they do a very good job in those areas. But now we probably just from a cost benefit, it doesn't, you know, we need to put them in a position where their skills, their training, specific training can be best utilized for the city.
Yeah, I hope that message has come through here, that this is not any indication that we need that we have too many police officers or firefighters. That's not at all what we're talking about. We're just saying we need them in the most effective position, and in the future, we're still have a great need for more.
And this, if we had the funding, this would be another way to add positions without having to do an academy. You would move people out of the administrative and put them out in the field and keep them there for a long period of time, but we just don't have the funding to do that.
Yeah, well, kudos to the police and fire department for being frugal and for identifying ways that they can save money by utilizing civilians more. I'm sorry. Please continue, Candace.
If I could, just one other question I have, and maybe this isn't the appropriate time. In regards to the community care units and how they were able to handle some of the non-fire-related calls, but the medical calls without using sworn personnel, my understanding was it was half and half, one sworn and one non-sworn. Can you comment on if that's a direction that we should continue in with the grant expiring, or is that in not an efficiency? Or are we not going in that direction?
Well, I think we will address that issue in the discussion. It's kind of a broader, longer term vision.
Fair enough.
These are kind of immediate impacts, but that's certainly a discussion we will have the chief talk about.
Okay.
I see Chief Camelli in the back of the room, and I know that she knows that question is going to be front and center. I'm sure she's going to lead with that when she comes to see us in an interview. Thank you.
Yeah, and then
please
Mayor,
continue.
And Mayor and Councilmember Whitaker, that's great. Those are any type of a service, anytime that we're providing the services, especially our core services to our residents, we're in constant review of that. And that was a great program a great grant to have for that department to take a look at providing service a different way. And I know they're still rolling through the data, they're still rolling through the information, and looking at all the different ways of providing the service that needs for our residents. So we'll be continuing those discussions along the way. The next area regarding personnel is basically what I kind of mentioned a little bit, which is the fire department, which is the repurposing of existing staff. And so that is actually taking those sworn positions in the fire and medical department that they identified that are currently providing more administrative type duties within the department, still important but administrative in nature, and taking those positions and actually adding them to what we call the leave pool, which is those positions that are available for your sick and your vacation call outs. When they have to call somebody in on overtime, this would give additional people ready to take those shifts on and save us on the overtime side. So they still identified additional positions just like the police department. These people are currently providing more administrative duties in nature. They're not on a truck, they're not on a unit, and they would be moving over to being on a truck or on a unit or in the leave pool. So it would add these positions and people, more people out to the street is what this would result in, and would result in reduced overtime. The duties would be then taken, and some of them would be combined with other positions. So we'd have one captain, we'd have two captains doing two different things. Now the one captain would take on the duties of both of those positions and maybe move to some other staff within the department as well. And then some of the would just be less. So like the training captain would only come in when they're needed. The CIP captain that they originally had would come in when they're doing kind of some facility remodel or something. Somebody in the department would take on those kind of duties on an as-needed basis rather than on a full-time basis.
Are you available?
Our last area or method that we apply to our personnel is obviously our method of last resort, which is actually the elimination of positions. And so going through doing the city, sometimes this is a needed course when we're talking about budgets and trying to stay within our resources. So we do have a variety of departments or a variety of positions that have been identified for elimination. We have 12 that the police department has identified. Six of those are sworn positions, six of those are civilian positions. We do not lay off sworn officers. Of the sworn positions, four of them are currently filled, two of them are currently vacant. The four employees would act just like the other ones. They would go out into budgeted vacant positions. They would be overhires until the point that a position was available. All of the civilians we're talking about here, all these civilian positions are currently vacant, so there is no impact on our existing employees when it comes to these eliminations. Three and a half positions, and it's really four positions, but one's a part-time in the information technology department, one position in business services department, and then I was neglectful and I did miss one position in engineering that they have identified as well that's also vacant. And then arts and culture has also identified one position that will be vacant due to retirement in the upcoming year, and when that retirement happens, then that position would not be filled at that time. That's the end of the personnel, or that personnel side. If there isn't any other questions, then we'll move on to the other areas of the budget.
Thank you. Any additional questions? Okay, thank you.
Okay. One of the things that we are dealing with is the impact of the minimum wage increase. While the impact to our direct employees was minimal, usually our seasonal employees are where we had it the most in our parks department, with our lifeguards and so forth. Where we are seeing it is in our contracts. So our contracts for landscaping and our contracts for custodial, we are receiving and budgeting for additional increases in those contracts next year. We're looking at $250,000 increase in our landscaping contract for parks. And then for the city facilities, $50,000 increase in landscaping at city facilities, and $170,000 increase in custodial at city facilities. So overall, it's about a $470,000 impact to the budget. The park side is all general fund area. The city facilities depends on the facility. Some of those are in our utility building. That would be enterprise fund. At Mesa City Plaza, that would be the general fund, those types of things. So we are seeing an increase in that. So where you'll see and you'll hear from Mark Hirschberg this Thursday, the first department that will be presenting to you will be Parks, Recreation, and Community Facilities. And he'll talk to you a little bit more about how they're dealing with those increases and the reductions that they have put in place to try to keep stay within resources.
Excuse me, Candace, so I heard you say about $470,000 for some of the park and recreation contracts, but then all together, not just, what is the financial impact of the minimum wage increase?
That's the 470.
470 for the
right,
entire
total.
City.
On the park side, they have the park side and they have the city facility side. We kind of treat them a little bit separately.
I see.
So on our parks facilities, which is actually contracted out in the various zones where they do the park maintenance, that increase that we have included in the proposed budget is about $250,000 increase, and that would be completely general fund that would be paying for that. And then on the city facilities, so that's upkeeping our buildings, the landscaping around our buildings, and then custodial within our buildings, it's about $50,000 on the landscaping side and about $170,000 on the custodial side, and that would be based on the building. So if it's at the utility building, that would be paid for by the enterprise fund. If it's at the Mesa City Plaza, that'd be paid for by the general fund and so forth. So those funds would be a little bit different.
Okay. And altogether, $470,000.
Altogether,
okay.
About $470,000 of indirect costs regarding the minimum wage increase.
Thank you.
As we go forward, again, the second part of the financial stability or sustainability is preparing for the growth and opportunity of tomorrow. And so in proposed budget for 17-18, we do continue the capital improvement projects that address infrastructure needs in our growing areas of the city. Specifically, most of it is in the southeast portion of Mesa, but there's also other areas around that have either the widening of a road or the additional water lines and those types of things. Obviously, our main ones are the new water plant, the Signal Butte Water Treatment Facility, and the expansion of the Greenfield Water Reclamation Plant, which is on the enterprise side. also included in the proposed budget for 17-18 is an annual allocation that's been included to assist in the stimulation of utility customer growth. This is a new allocation from the Enterprise Fund to the Economic Investment Fund for the purposes of investing and stimulating economic growth that would then result in additional customer base for those utilities. Falcon Field Area Marketing Plan, which includes a branding project, has been included in the proposed budget. This is one of the areas within the city that's been designated as a marketing area that we want to increase. And this would be in addition to the signage program that we have going on this year, where they're working on some unique signage for that area similar to the Fiesta area. Some good news on our secondary property tax rate. We will be reducing the rate for fiscal year 17-18. We want to make sure that we understand the difference between the levy and the rate. The levy, the secondary property tax levy, is a total dollar amount that will be collected by the city, and we keep that static each year. So each year it's about $33 million, and we keep that. And then we change the rate. The rate is based on the assessed value of the city. So the higher the rate, the higher the assessed value, the lower the rate. So the more we grow our assessed value, the lower we can do the rate across all of the existing customers. One of the main things we want to talk about here is that the more we have new construction, we increase the construction, that's an increased value to the city of Mesa, and that actually spreads that same levy over more people, and therefore lowers the rate on the average consumer.
So the council will be approving a property tax rate decrease this year, about 5%?
Yes.
About 5%.
Which reflects the increase in the property values.
It's both new construction growth and higher values.
Yeah.
So even if your values are going up, there'll be a 5%.
Yeah.
This is a general number, so we can't speak to everybody specifically, but based on the numbers, the total numbers, the gross numbers we get from the appraiser, that's what we'll be doing. We'll be able to decrease the tax rate, property tax rate, by about 5%.
So the assessed value for the city of Mesa went up by 5.6% going into the next year, and 2.5% of that was due to new construction. So we're building our base. We're increasing our base, and that's allowing us to decrease the rate for your average household.
So this would be one example of why population growth is good, because the
population and commercial growth.
Commercial growth.
Because our big, construction sales tax and permit, some of the biggest bumps are coming from the big economic development projects that are underway right now.
So the bigger the tax base paying property tax, the lighter the burden it is
low
spread
rates,
across.
Broad-based, low rates. That's what they teach in finance. Broad-based, low rates.
Okay. Good for us.
Outside of positions and personnel costs, there are others. All the departments participated in reviewing their expenditure budgets for next year and recommending decreases in their various areas. And so you'll hear from some of those over the next month as they come through and kind of highlight some of the reductions that they have included in their proposed budget for 17-18. And then for those that you do not hear from directly, I will wrap those up in the wrap-up on May 4th and highlight some of those who did not speak to you personally, and make sure that we highlight those reductions that they have looked for and included in their proposal as well. There are two sides, both the expense side and the revenue side. We want to make sure that we're always looking at both, always looking for those opportunities to recover costs whenever possible. On the increased revenue side, we do have the municipal court will have some revenue enhancement due to the participation in what's called the state's FAIR program, which is the fine or fee, and restitution enforcement. So what this will actually do is for those fines and fees that are on the books and haven't been paid and usually end up going to collections, we used to collect on those as well, is that we'll actually, someone who owes money will not be able to re-register their vehicle until it has been either paid or dealt with in some manner that cleans it off the record. So that will actually hold it up. And so we do anticipate some increases for next year. Some of those will be one time, some from some back collections that we haven't had for quite some years. We think that those will come in next year. That'll give us some one-time money, but it'll also give us some ongoing money as we feel that the fines and fees will be paid a little more timely throughout the years coming up. So that'll give us some revenues there. Some of the other departments have also come up with some revenue enhancement ideas. Some of them will present those to you as they come forward individually. They have not been, some of the larger ones have not been included in the proposed budget because they just need additional work and research to actually put a program or a fee together. And so we wanted to use a little work on that and not count on it right now in 17-18 because it may take us a couple months or a few months to put it together. And we also do have the 60-day policy. Once we do have the recommendation, we'd still have 60 days of notification before we're able to actually implement new fees. And so we haven't included it in the proposed budget, but you will be hearing a little bit from those. Fire and Medical Department is one of those departments that has some revenue ideas that they'll be bringing forward. When we pull this all together, we really have the three different areas that we talked about. One is the estimated decreases in all of those various personnel and position moves that we had, as well as we have some increases that we need to do according to in order to meet our requirements for the minimum wage and the costs and the impact for those, as well as the revenues. And when you pull that all together, the net impact is $8.6 million decrease in the funding gap. So when we start with your beginning, so we started with that beginning where we started, and then we look at that, there'll be an $8.6 million difference in that funding gap. So if you go to the next slide, you can kind of see it. And again, it's on your handout where you can see a little bit easier, the before and after, if you will, starting point and where our proposed budget is. And so if you look at their starting, we look at where we are here, you can see, again, we're looking at that net sources and uses. So again, that is our important line. Whenever you're looking at this chart, you want to look at the net sources and uses. So where we started when we started this budget was $17.5 million was our funding gap as we're going into the 17-18 fiscal year. And where we come after our proposed budget with the items that we've identified today, our funding gap would be down to only $8.9 million for that. Now you see kind of below, I wanted to make sure that these were separate. I didn't want to net these together. The $8.9 million is a funding gap, and you see that implementation phase in. That's that about $2.1 million for phasing in those sworn positions that will be, in essence, overhires for the first 6 to 12 months. That's the funding for those. I wanted to put them a separate line for you because you see that that's temporary funding just for the 1 year. Okay. So it does not carry out to the other years. So the ongoing savings that we would achieve by doing that is then comes out into all of the other years. And so what you really start to see is the cumulative effect of the decisions that we make today. So what we make today and the implementation that may take us 6 to 12 months for some of these to be fully implemented, when you look just out 2 years into the forecast for the 1920 fiscal year 1920, you can see our starting point, we were estimating an ending fund balance of only 4.9%. Based on the proposed budget today, that would double up to 10% and bring us within the financial goal policy of a minimum of 8 to 10% for those. And so you can kind of see how it may not look like it's a huge impact in the first year and maybe not even in the second year, but as you start really going out, you can see the impact that decisions we have today makes in just 2 years. One of the things I do want to point out as part of this proposed budget is this is just changing the base. So what this does is it resets the base level of operations and it allows us time to continue our review and consideration of our needs and our anticipated resources. What it does not address is it does not address any of our increasing our ongoing life cycle that we've talked about. Things like software technology uses or, you know, new software products and those types of things. It does also not address facility repairs and remodels above our current level of our funding or replacement of park equipment, those types of things. So those kind of large life cycle type items, we have not changed anything in here from that original forecast that we showed you in February. So those would still be things we'd be looking for one-time savings each year, and then we fund the highest priority items as we go through, which is what we've been doing for the last few years.
Again, it's just to be clear, the chart that you just gave us anticipates that in forecast 2021, the reserve balance would be 6.6%. We're not going to let that happen.
No.
But it's
better than the zero we had before.
Yes, yeah. Right.
So we're working there. And that's the good news is we've seen that much adjustment improvement from just what we're proposing in the budget today. But we believe that as each year we, just like this last year, this year we made some changes. We got the next 2 years to come inside of our guidelines. We expect we could do that in the next year. And as you, the council knows, we try to be very conservative, not ultra conservative. So hopefully next year when we're working on this budget, that won't be so difficult. It'd be a lot more difficult. You can tell the number at 22.9 million in the chart up above, we've got that back down to $14.6 million. So we've made big progress in this budget because there's just what happens, there's a compounding effect to a lot of decisions that we make. So we're not out of the woods yet, but we know for at least we bought another year or two and we can come back next year. You know, maybe the economy keeps improving. We just need to keep finding ways. We have some issues that we're kicking down the road that we're gonna have to address. We've gotta be more competitive in our pay for our employees. We've gotta handle life cycle issues. So those are issues that we're going to have to address during the forecast period.
Mr. Whitaker.
Does this assume a PSPRS return of 7.5% or 0.5% this forecast budget?
The forecast assumes all of the changes and the assumptions from the actuarial studies that came through. So this has the $12 million impact. Down. Right, for so we in the that original presentation back in February, we kind of gave you an itemized list of what was comprised of that $12 million. And that this includes the $12 million impact each year going out. It also includes a $6 million anticipated impact based on the next case, on the Hall case for 18-19. That would start in 18-19. And so we're watching that. That anticipation is. Now that has to do with going from the decrease in the employee side of it. So everything that was in here before, so this was the original forecast that we showed you back in February, that included all of those public safety, personnel retirement system assumptions that we had there. And so that is included in here. And everything we know about the pension plan is included in here.
Which only applies to this year's, it doesn't apply to any of the fiscal year like 18, 19 and beyond. Right?
It rolls through it.
It rolls through it.
It becomes a recurring cost. Yes, it does. It hits us this year, but it stays in the number each year.
It increases the base in fiscal year 17, 18, and then that base is forecasted out for the those next years.
So it's a number that gets stuck in there and stays in the budget.
Perpetual.
Yes. From this year, yeah, but let's say next year the return isn't the anticipated 7.5 percent that they anticipate in their actuarials every year.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Yes.
Next year, are we going to get, is this going to be another $12 million base that we have to then apply to the next 3 years again? This right. is not, it's not anticipated in this.
Yes, it's a great question. So the answer that we give is this. We, the city of Mesa, because I know there's always a lot of questions about where numbers come from. The only numbers we put into this budget are based on the actuarial that is provided to us by PSPRS. We do not run, we run it to apply it to our payroll number, but it's a margin of error, not too significant. But we take the rates from the actuarial study that's done by a third party for PSPRS. And so there are adjustments, like your point, there are adjustments down to what is the actual anticipated return, but we don't run a separate number. We only take what is given to us.
So what I would ask is hypothetically, are the actuarials were off this year, and that was a $12 million adjustment that we had to make to the budget. Is that correct? Was the adjustment $12 million?
Yes.
Yes. Adjustment for 17-18 was a $12 million adjustment.
So if we assume the actuarials are wrong on that same thing in 3 years, that could be a $36 million liability on our FY 2021 budget, right?
Well, Mayor and Councilmember Whitaker, what you need to look at is that $12 million was not just on that one item of interest or return on investment for those. There were many different items, and most of it had to do with the actual changes in the legislation and the changes in the benefits.
There was multiple
and so
things.
It wouldn't be a $12 million. $12 million wasn't the effect of just that one assumption on the rate of return. That was just one piece of a very long laundry list. And so those items would not change because that's the change in benefits. And so we wouldn't see a change in those. But you are correct. If there is a change in the rate on return on investment, there would be a change. It wouldn't be $12 million, though. And they actually spread that out. So if their interest that they receive, their investment they receive in 1 year is not what they expected, they don't recover that in 1 year. They actually recover it over 7 years.
Got it.
So everything they do is kind of a rolling 7 years. Yeah, it's a very small. So the bulk of it was based on the benefit changes, not the actuarial assumption changes.
And that's spread out over how many years? I mean, let's say there's another $3.9 million.
So if it didn't hit this mark.
Right, if it doesn't hit the 7.5% return again.
It may be. Right?
And there's another $3.9 million liability. How long is that spread out? How many years?
Usually what they do is they take, it's on return on investment, and take it out over 7 years.
Okay. So it could be significant to our liabilities in the next 4 years in regards to the forecast.
Correct. And Mayor and Councilmember Whitaker, those are the public safety pension is really one of those items that we look for every year. We try to anticipate things that are going, but unfortunately, it's just one of those things that we're unfortunately in a reactionary mode most of the time. And not able to proact. We are trying to be proactive on the Hall case, but in 18-19, we are already putting in our estimate of how we feel that we're going to be impacted by that, and that is then rolled through. So that then increases the base in 18-19 and then rolls through the other ones. So those are both in there through the entire forecast.
Thank you.
Thank you. Proceed.
All right. So to wrap up the summary, of what we're doing. And so we just provided you a list of the departments. Like I said, most of the departments will be coming before you within the month of April. Not all of them. Some of the smaller ones or some of the more internal ones will not be actually doing independent presentations. It does not mean they're not important. It just means that we only have so many spots in the month of April. And so we will be summarizing those on May 4th for you, anyone who does not appear before you. If you have any other questions, though, if there's somebody on here that you would like more information from and we did not schedule them, or you want a particular topic, maybe not the whole department, then just let us know. We want to make sure that we get the information to you during the month of April that you need in order to make your decisions before we come back on May 4th and wrap it up. Then because starting in May on the very last one here is the actual process, these are all the items in May and June that you will be asked to consider and take action on the various pieces of the budget and how it all kind of comes together at the end. So you will be adopting various pieces along the way, and at the very end we'll have it all wrapped up and everything will be done by June 10th.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I think you can tell we need to schedule plenty of time for these meetings because
you got them. We're here all Thursdays.
About 20 minutes over on this meeting already. So thank you very much, Candace. Next item on our agenda is the item 2B, appointment to the Fire Department Pension Board. Is there a motion to that effect? Thank you. Motion second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Thank you. Item 3, acknowledge receipt of minutes of various boards and committees. Is there a motion to that effect? Thank you, Mr. Freeman. Mr. Thompson gets the second on that one. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Item 4, hear reports on meetings and conferences attended. Hearing none, the next item is schedule of future meetings and general information. Mr. Brady.
Mayor, I'll take care of that on Thursday.
Thank you. Is there a motion to adjourn this meeting?
So moved.
Thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. We're adjourned and we'll convene upstairs.